But I hope that everybody will learn something from this talk and bring in different perspectives during the Q&A session. Without further ado, I'll give the floor to Svyatoslav Vakarchuk.
Thank you very much.
Probably seen in my lectures, or you know what I'm talking about, and I'm pushing the idea of education and, you know, changing of Ukrainian young people mindset and a sort of enlightening for young generation. So probably things I'm talking, I will talk about, will be based on my actually idea of education and enlightenment, will be based on my ideas. Do you have classical education here in the university? So do they teach you Plato and Aristotle?
Yes.
So we'll start from that. We'll start from Plato and Aristotle, and these are two very interesting guys. Although Aristotle was a sort of disciple or just probably student of Plato. But he proposed a completely different approach to life and different ideas than his teacher Plato did. So Plato always considered statecraft through a lens of his philosophical approach. In his famous book, Republic, you probably, many of you know this book, classical book, he proposed the concept of ideal state. All changes in his ideas basically are being done top down. So the idea is that you have somebody, some divine force or some wise force or some like world wisdom which drives these things, and from top down you can build a good state, good republic. He argues that both tyranny and autocracy and democracy all are bad. He always thinks that some of these, you know, state types are, actually all of these state types bring country into either into brinkmanship of war or to poverty. Plato did it and thought that way, not occasionally. He lived just in the time when Athens were ruined up by Sparta after the Peloponnesian Wars. And actually it was a normal thing to understand that you know, Athens as democracy was a bad idea because they were ruined, and Sparta as autocracy was also a bad idea because they were enemy. So he wanted to find his own way. And he said actually that power of wise man or aristocracy is the best way to build a prosperous society, prosperous country. But it should be implemented with the power of somebody from top down, having these good ideas, these wise men, and they should work, live in a good society, and then probably in a couple of steps, in a couple of generations, with these rules implementing top down, you'll come to this good society. Aristotle, in his book Politics, describes completely different view. He says, describes a household as a key to prosperity. So he brings the idea of bottom-up movement, when he says that a household is the main cell of a society, and when the household is doing well, and many households do well, they together make or create a good society, a good prosperous country. So actually these two ideas are opposing each other. What Plato says, everything is coming from top down, there is some divine idea implemented by wise aristocratic, you know, bunch of guys who give this wisdom and good to everybody. And Aristotle say, no, we need to do every day some things, day by day, every one of us, especially here, his key idea was a household, which is a family, and the family working every day in the field, doing land farming, doing fishing, going, like, you know, doing, you know, sailing. Man, when they did sailing in Athens, you know, trading, doing properly their work every day, being very efficient and professional in their own work, they will create a good society. These two ideas, they do oppose each other, and they, as you know from history of Christianity, Plato was a very, very serious figure for all early Christianity, because suddenly ideas and actually divine power suit too well the idea of Christianity. It was easy to, you know, to pull them together. They are sort of, in some ways, even coincided. And Aristotle was forgotten for a long time, because this idea that a man has his own power to change things was absolutely like abandoned, and actually was not hostile for a young Christianity. So only on the Renaissance time, and then the Enlightenment time, the New Age time, Aristotle once, and his ideas once again became popular and flourishing. So my basic idea is, I think these both guys are right. So you can't do something just with Aristotelian approach, and you can't do something with Plato's approach. I think we need to have both movements, top down, bottom up. And knowing that all these ancient Greek, they did like allegories and analogies, so I'll bring you one. Imagine that you need to set a fire. I mean, it's just to light a fire as something just to cook, or to warm up, or to heat up your place or something. So for that you need two things. Which are two things? Actually, you need a lighter or a match, which is lit by somebody, and then you need a wood, brushwood, right? So you need something, a material, which should be ready to be lit and carefully prepared. It is, like, if this brushwood is too moist, the fire is not going to be lit. If it's too dry, or say moulder, a fire is not going to be lit, because the first the brushwood which is too moist, you just can't set a fire. You know how it goes. And when it's too moulder, you probably have a fire in the very beginning, but will stop doing it, like, because actually you don't have a consistent material. You know, it's moulder, so you can't do that. Only a dry brushwood which is properly prepared, dry enough, but still consistent to the point that it is able to maintain a good fire, is something we're looking for. So fire, in my
allegory, in my fairy tale, is an energy or momentum society needs to make a leap toward prosperity. This is this energy, fire we need. And the match, or lighter, is a bunch of leaders, or a leader, one leader, with personal accumulated energy and person and passion, ready to lit this fire. And the brushwood is a civil society. And if civil society, moist brushwood is one kind of civil society, and molder is a different one. So, if society is moist, society is not still not ready to accept any energy. In fact, this brush would extinguish any fire by its accumulated moisture they have.
It just extinguishes. In other words, the society which is in this state is not ready to understand new ideas, to accept new energy, and to accept to impose a new paradigm, which is brought by new leaders. Those are just few new leaders. So you will never be elected as a political leader, as a new political leader with this passion and energy, by this moist brushless society. I'll come later to this point. In my point of view, this moist brushless is a part of society with lack of education and especially the narrow-minded approach to life, what we call sometimes, which is like, it's not my business. And it's too premature society, not ready for accepting these leaders. A dry or moderate brushwood is a society which waited for changes probably or for something for so long, and doesn't have this kind of heat or hidden energy which probably, this is society which longed or waited for so long for changes to happen, and they don't, they are already demoralized or distrusted or afraid of something because they have so many bad examples in their life, so they are already not ready for something new. So because of fear, because of paternalistic approach to life, because of their hope were disappointed for so many times, they are already this is a sort of this molder wood I was talking about. Thus we can conclude that new generation lacks education or special perception of life, or I would say not education, like enlightenment. So they need to not to be educated by enlightenment. So an old society has a lot of this distrust and they also not ready to accept something. So we have a paradox. We have distrust of this new part of society because they are not ready to accept, because they lack wisdom or broad-mindedness or education. And you also, and that's why they distrust. And also you have distrust of that older part of generation because they just, they distrust. The first distrust because of lack of expertise, and the second distrust because of they have too much of expertise and too much of, experience. So that is why our society is driven by distrust. Some things that I was trying to tell to Italy, who were present on our Columbia lecture. And they, but the good thing is, although you cannot turn a molder brushwood back into a proper one, but you can change, that means you cannot change older generation. And probably you don't need to do that. And you don't need to blame this generation for being something not ready to accept new ideas, because these people have lived their life for so long. They did a lot of hard work. Sometimes it's just not there. They were put into under circumstances where they were forced to live their way. So actually, I wouldn't blame somebody of these people who are not ready for something changes for that. So, but the truth, the wisdom is that you can't turn it, this old wood into a proper one, a molder wood in a proper one. You can't do it. Like, that's something that doesn't exist in nature. But you can convert a moist brushwood into a good one, in a proper one, just drying it out gradually up to the point it's ready to be lit. And to dry it out, it means to educate, or more importantly, to enlighten this new society. So what we need is two things, and I probably will put it there. A good bunch of leaders who are committed. Do we have some? Is there? So what do we need? We need both top down, which is a good bunch of leaders who are committed, who are daring, who are educated, who have strong stamina, who are ready to be this match or this lighter, name it. It's first thing, and then we need to have this proper wood, proper brushwood, which is educated and ready for new changes and ready to be led in civil society. By having used an analogy of lighting or to set a fire or something like that, I don't mean that we need a revolution. Like fire, it's not always fire that burns buildings. Sometimes fire maintains life. And in our, and fire always creates new energy. So my analogy is something that deals with energy, which our society and all societies, not only Ukrainian, but all societies which want to be prosperous need. This energy, and the third thing, we need a right place and right time for these two to meet. So, what I state here is that every country that is doing not so well has, like, the causes of that are here. So they either are lacking of their leaders, either the civil society is not ready for their leaders, either the time and place to meet them was not right. And I will bring for you a funny, I'll draw a funny graph now, and you'll see what I mean. So assume that usually leaders are here as like level of enlightenment or education, let's say education and enlightenment, both start with E, so take your pick. Here's time. Assume the leaders are already in some level, so they're here, these are leaders. Assume the society is here, starting from here. So we need to educate society, so they come to this point. Somewhere in the time they need. And here the change starts happening. Here is a tipping point where we start doing this momentum, this energy. We let, like, start to work and a mutual process of this, you know, of this top-down and bottom-up movement start to work and to really to do things. It's one situation. It's a good situation. The other situation is, assume you say, okay, if society is more educated at the very beginning, or more enlightened than the leaders are. So the leaders are here, and the society is here, and they're coming here. So the more the gap between them expands, the more society understands that they need new leaders, so they just find somebody here. And they still will be safe, because they just change this for this, which is sometimes elections, sometimes revolutions, sometimes different. So they will still find this. But the worst thing, can you see it here down? But the worst thing happens, it's enlightenment and time. The worst thing happens when here are leaders, and here is the society. They will never meet. They're moving parallel way. But that happens only when society doesn't change their quality, their education, their, like, you know, mindset in time. That we don't have that. We have a, like, not only homogeneous but also permanent state of, you know, of non-graduate, or how you call it, I don't know. Like, it's we call it, like, I call it just stagnation. Well, that's what I call it. So they will never meet, and there will be never a right point. So what I want to say, and what I want to say here, that the only, in all these three situations, we have the first two actually have their tipping point, the third not. What is different between first two and the third? The society is changing. It's moving upwards. That means that the basic thing we come to, in order to come to the point where the changes are inevitable, we need to bring the society bottom up to this point. That's why we need an educated and enlightened new generation who's gonna do that. It's that simple. It's nothing else. So, that is a theory. Practically, once again, I want to say that Ukraine now, coming back to Ukraine, coming to a practical world, Ukraine now faces a very serious time, a very interesting time. So we we certainly are not, I assume, and I dare say, we are not on the third graph. Probably the problem of, I think we are the first graph, but, or probably the second one, which is actually, the first and the second are both good. The second requires more time to understand that your leaders are bad and you need to change them, but it's still good. It doesn't matter, first or second. I think that we are on the first or second, but the problem is that the angle of graduation of our growth, of our rise, is very little, very small. So we need to do it faster. In order to foster or to bolster the things or to gain, to boost this educational growth, we need some practical steps. And recently, by some volunteers here in New York and myself, we had a discussion and a meeting how to bring more Ukrainian students here to America and to other European and not only European countries, in order to study here and to obtain and to get new kind of education. Once again, when I talk about education, why I so often I use the other word to enlightenment and education. I don't mean by the word education some specific knowledge or expertise you need to become a good professional. Because these things, like to become a good engineer, good physicist, good biologist, or even good historian, you still can study, for example, in Ukraine. You can do that. We have good people who can, good professors. I have a degree in theoretical physics, and I can say that I published my articles in best American and English journals, and they accepted it very readily, and everything was all right. The problem is not that. The problem is not your expertise and knowledge in some field. The problem is your mindset, your paradigm in which you live, and your approach to life. That Ukrainian education today lacks. And not because it's bad, because it's never had it. This approach to life, which is absolutely normal, typical, and conventional wisdom here in the West, have been created by a long period of time, by many centuries and many generations of people, and there were so many mistakes and good and bad things, and finally, probably in hundreds of, sometimes in a thousand of years, Western Europe in the end of 17th, 18th century came to these ideas and brought into life a set of values we now call Western values, in which the prosperous societies of the West are living. Once again, we can argue about different set of values, Eastern values, and that's probably a subject of discussion or different lecture. But still, we see now that this approach to life, this mindset that we have here in America or Western Europe or some countries in other part of the world, which are actually, touched or even saturated with these Western values, like countries of the Commonwealth or countries of the Southeast Eastern Asia, like Hong Kong and Singapore or Japan, who were following up all these Western societies. We still lag that in Ukraine. So in order to achieve that, we need process in atomic physics, they enrich uranium. We need to enrich this uranium we have already. Because I believe the Ukrainian nation has a lot of talented people, has a great potential, has a great land, has we have a very good starting points and starting conditions. The only thing we lack is this specific and very successful and very, distinct approach to life, which Ukrainians, because of many things, of history, of upbringing, of culture, whatever name it, lack or didn't have. And my idea is, just to using words of famous words of Ronald Reagan to tear down this wall, the wall that Ukraine is surrounded by. Outside this wall, we have this Western approach to life, which brings you suddenly material prosperity, but also some way makes people think more responsible. It's a sort of self-responsibility. What people here probably have or probably possess to high degree than in Ukraine. And to do that practically, we can have different things. First, we can bring a lot of students here, America, Britain, France, Germany, all other prosperous countries. Secondly, we also can bring, not necessarily Ukrainian students, but should come here. We can also organize a process, a mutual process of coming, professionals, scholars, students from other parts of the world to Ukraine as well. Especially the good idea is to invite, for example, American or English-speaking volunteers to students to come to Ukraine and to become teachers of English language for kindergartens or schools. And also we can invite famous, distinguished scholars and professors to give their lectures and to learn our people, not only remotely, but being there face to face. This is a very complicated and a very, slow process, but we need to start at least now. Because when we talk about, for example, sometimes I hear argument what America can do for Ukraine, being a sort of a formally and the country which recognizes itself as an ally of Ukraine, what it should do. And we argue a lot about giving billions of of financial aid or the questions of lethal weapon today, and these are the most highly discussed and negotiated questions there in the summits on a high level. But I wonder why nobody talks about bringing 5 or 10,000 Ukrainian students with level of English. First of all, provide them with a good level of English, and then bring them here to study. When somebody says to me, it's something that can be bad, it can be supported by American government as well, and at least it's much more, noble aid than to say. So I imagine like the President of the United States staying on the lawn of near the White House and saying that we help Ukraine by this way, bringing the best of their students here, and everybody applauding. It's not something that you say, we need to provide them with javelins because half of the world will be angry and the half of the world will say, you're once again doing this, providing, imposing this militaristic approach. So I understand that leaders are not ready when they ask for weapons. But what about education? I think it's much more serious and much more strategic, long-range strategic weapon or missile than any other missile we're talking about. And nobody in Ukraine in the high level, as far as I'm concerned, and nobody started to push this idea on a governmental level. But coming back to bottom-up movement, what I want to say that probably we don't need to wait for that, and we need to start doing things little by little ourselves. Probably not in thousands of students or young people, but in units or tens or dozens or hundreds, but probably we can do something. So what my basic idea is for everybody yourself is that this new kind of mindset is what Ukraine now needs. And one big problem that we have is that many, and it's probably the last thing I want to stop by and emphasize. coming back for like this volunteering movement in Ukraine, we have a lot of volunteers, and you especially last couple of years after the Revolution of Dignity and after all turmoil and the war in the East, we see this like growth and development of volunteer movement. These people are passionable, but not always consistent enough. And you know, they are passionate, but not patient enough to do things gradually, day by day, for years. They want to help today. They are ready to work. They are ready to do something. But sometimes they, as all this, you know, young wood, young moist wood, they just lack of, you know, of many things, of know-how, of this new approach. They still distrust government, which is absolutely obvious. They sometimes distrust themselves. They don't think that they can do things. They're still not that strong. So we need to encourage these people. We need to inspire them. The best way of encouragement is like to give them some new tool set or some new, you know, perception. They probably will use that and they will be more successful. Because you know, these volunteers are passionable, but not consistent enough. But then you have professionals who know what to do in their life, and they're shrewd enough, but they don't see a light at the end of the tunnel, and then they say, come on, I don't see the point of doing something for my country, I'll better do something for my life. I'm consistent, I'm self-responsible, so I'll go, for example, to the United States, some other country, I'll get myself educated, I'll get a degree, I'll change my life, and I'll forget about Ukraine because just this country is there for me. I mean, I can do something for my life, for my family here, and it's a completely new life, and I just don't care. So we have these two part of people, and we can't change this second approach. So if you have this second kind of people, it's something that is their mind. They are educated enough, they know what they want in life, but persuade them to change and to become, really volunteer coming back and to start things from the very beginning. But these first people, these passionate young volunteers who are there in Ukraine, who can do something, who want to do something, they just lack sometimes the strength of character, sometimes of these new possibilities you guys have here. So they will be ready to come back and to do something. They just need this push. So I want to help them. I want to help these kind of people. And in fact, sometimes I'm told, you know, okay, you bring all these young students, 80% of them will stay here. Okay, so what? The 20% make difference. If you bring 500 people, probably 20%, it's like 100 people, it won't make a big difference. But if you bring 5,000 or 10,000 people, 2,000 people coming, it's passionable, with strong stamina, already with different approach to life, ready to work every day, like American pioneers in 18th or 19th century, conquering West, they will do the stuff. They will change things. And we need these people. So I truly believe that without these people, all longing and all, you know, hopes for somebody in Plato's idealistic like approach, somebody to come, some wise man to come and to change us, that's not gonna happen, guys. That never happens in any society. Look at history of all societies which started rapidly to change. It was always two of these lines on the graph which met. So my sentence, or my main idea to you is that if you want your, and I understand that for 60-70% here, Ukraine is a motherland and is a country where you're from. If you want your country to be prosperous, here are two things. Recipe has two points. First, encourage, inspire, and help as many of your brothers and sisters come here or other countries and educate themselves. Secondly, change, which is probably much more difficult, change your perception of life and understand that not only your life matters personally, but also the life of the country. And do something, come back and do something. You'll make a difference, guys. That's what I want to say. Probably it's a little bit tough and a little bit not the things you were ready for, but at least it's honest, it's something that here inside. So sorry for that. By these words, I'm going to finish. The last thing I want to say, that here in the United States, I'm so encouraged to meet every day so many people who care about Ukraine, good Ukrainian people, good Americans, good people from other countries who care about Ukraine and who are so keen and, you know, encouraged to do something for this country, that makes me my optimism. They make it, you know, flourishing. So I think that's a very good news. So I will come back to my country with this idea that it's only the beginning of this new road that Ukraine has. And I strongly believe that only when these two lines, this bunch of good leaders who gotta sacrifice their lives and who gotta be passionate and energetic and inspiring, and though also this big new, vast amount of new representatives of civil society Ukrainians, when they meet at that point, the miracle or the magic is going to happen.
Very much up to that.
Yes, I'm ready to have. Moreover, you can ask me some specific questions as well. It's not only political philosophy. It's just, I wanted to start with it. Yeah, please.
I'm obviously one of the older people here. How many people here are immigrants from Ukraine? Sorry. This was actually by far the best talk that we can do something here in New York City that is actually quite spectacular, that will help. New York City will give you all the millions of dollars you need to create a Ukrainian lead city. And it's a charter movement in New York City, and all you have to do is organize yourself. In fact, there are even American organizations that will organize yourself. The only thing you have to provide is the teachers. And the teachers can be important to you. They can have a model school here at the expense of the New York City government that will provide a communication in which, first of all, they'll gather all of you, because all of you will have children. There are a lot of people here who look like they will have children in the future. Right? This will be something that we can work on that will continue the conversation, because there will always be a place for Svyatoslav to come to talk about the future, about education, and about learning from America in the West.
Thank you. Can you introduce yourself to who you are?
My name is Bogdan Oreshkevich.
And what do you do?
Sorry?
And what is your connection with the university?
I don't have a connection with this university, no.
Okay, maybe just for a change, since there are so few people of non-Ukrainian descent, maybe I will try to give them the privilege of asking the question.
They have any.
Nobody has.
Yeah, you know, I don't know about Fordham, but you know probably that we in Yale now, you know, warn very much all these things, you know. All these discriminational things. We are very cautious on that, and I think that's a very important thing, that we live in and we are now in a society which is absolutely homogeneous from moral ethical point of view, and we need to have this sort of this society to build in Ukraine as well.
Yeah, I think that needs to be exclusive.
Yeah.
I just wanted to broaden the conversation.
My name is Maria, I'm from Reddit.
thank you for these two wonderful questions. First question, yes, I do have, I do run a foundation which is called People of the Future. And we basically started it up as a foundation with a primarily with a goal, primary goal of helping educational issues. Unfortunately, the war changed our plans, and we now deal mostly with direct aid to hospitals, to people who suffer from aftermath and consequences of war, and it sort of, you know, slowed our plans down. But we will certainly come back to our ideas, with educational ideas and issues. I think that this exchange of students, I will put it, or exchange of scholars, students, and specialists between West and Ukraine, Ukrainian world and Western world, this will be something that we will be focused on, and this is will there will be a field of our main basic, you know, interest. I can't say you now what will be the specific plan, but for sure I'm already inspired, and we like these things, like bringing Ukrainian students here, bringing Americans or Europeans or people from other countries. It's very important that I'm not only focused on America, to Ukraine, and having this mutual process of exchange constant. This is my primary goal. The second question. If I knew that, I probably would have been an oracle. But I gave you here a theory which I truly believe is 100% correct. The problem with the theory is you never before you have an experimental data, you never know the numbers. So I don't know the numbers. I hope, as all of us, I think, that it will happen as soon as possible. But be careful and be ready to know that this as soon as possible not will be will not gonna happen tomorrow. Or probably even day after tomorrow. It will take a while. I don't know. In a good optimistic approach, 5-10 years. In pessimistic approach, generation or two. But the truth, or the wisdom, is that Moses needed 40 years for the people of Israel to completely change their mindset. By having said that, I don't mean that we need to wait literally 40 years. Who knows? Probably it will be 4 years for some things. Probably it will be 100 years. I don't know. But the Bible teaches us that all big fundamental changes, which I call tectonic shifts, take time, take a while. So just what we need to do, what we need to have, we need to have a little patience.
Okay, except for the patience, what also do we need? Does Ukraine need to become a prosperous state, according to your theory? So, leaders, civil society, and right timing.
No, we have many things. Thank you. Many things we need, and it was not a lecture on strategy. It was lecture on probably it was my thoughts on why do we have this distrust and why we still, you know, don't see probably this light at the end of the tunnel. I tried to explain what we need to change, because we change everything. We try to change, you know, our geopolitical friends and enemies. We try to change our political system. We come, we switch to presidential republic, to parliamentary, and vice versa. We argue one or two languages we need. We think of many, we already, you know, picked all the, like, you know, approaches and things we already, people have in the world. We have different constitutions, but well, we're still moving in parallel, these, like, you know, leaders and society moves in two parallel lines. We need to make them intersect. And that was my idea. But we need many things. If we can call about, you probably, have you been to Colombia when I spoke? So probably I can shortly come back to say that we need to change our mindset, which, for purposes of which, we need education. But this mindset, these 5 points, I have someone here. It's like this: build nation, build not do, a nation should be built not on the past but on the future. One. Second, there is no enemies, there is no friends, there are no enemies, no friends, there are only interests. Third, I be aware and cautious of your geographic and geostrategic position. It's not gonna change. You can't move plains, mountains, borders, and nations. They are there and they will be still there. Then civil society is one of the things I was talking about. 100% of involvement of civil society. And the fifth one, all those strategies you do need to support sustainability. You need to be sure whatever you do, whatever step you make, gradually you need to move forward. No move back, only forward. Doesn't matter, is it 1 millimeter, 1 feet, or, you know, or a mile, doesn't matter, just go forward. Every, you know, step of you, every issue, every point of the strategy should be subject to this approach. And it's easy to say, but it's very difficult to change. Because actually these five things I named, it's something that Ukraine doesn't use today at all. So we're not thinking of future, we're thinking of past. We're still a nation which likes to think that there is something that unites us, that unifies us, is past. Which probably is not a bad thing, but once again, probably I'll say it 100 times in my life, but past, don't mix up, don't confuse past and memory. Because memory is a torch on the road to future, or a beacon on the road to future. Past is a burden you carry in your backpack. And these are two different things. We sometimes mix it up. That's a big problem with Ukraine. No enemies, no friends. That's a very wise statement. The first was said by the United Kingdom Prime Minister Lord Palmerston in the beginning of the middle of 19th century. He said that Great Britain has no permanent enemies. Great Britain has no permanent friends. Great Britain only has permanent interests. Something that our politicians still not think of. We need to find an enemy, and moreover, we need to find a friend. We are so lonely, as you know, as a young teenager girl without her boyfriend. We need somebody, you know? We're so lonely. We don't have friends, we feel bad. Sorry, guys, we don't need friends. And we don't need enemies. We need interests. We need to know. It's not a human life, human being life. It's different. We just need to know what is our goal and go there gradually, step by step, every day. Just don't care. Sometimes people who were yesterday your biggest enemies will become your situative allies, not friends, but allies, and vice versa. People who yesterday supported you or you supported, they become your adversaries. But it's always, everything changes. Once again, that's something from Aristotle. Everything is in movement every day. So don't think like in this narrow-minded framework. The third thing is like geography. Once again, so just stop complaining about geography. Not because it's good or bad. It won't change. It will never be different. So what's the point to complain? Just accept it and do the things. What's the point to complain that, you were like 1.75 or 1.76 centimeters high as I am, if you want to become like 2 meters or 1.90? I can't think of that every morning. It can, soak my, absolutely, can spoil and poison my soul every day. But what's the point? Let's enjoy life a bit high. It's great. I can do that. So that's something Ukraine needs to think. And like civil society already spent like a whole bunch of time for that. And the last thing about these strategic, strategies that support sustainability. We always see something from, we are at point A and we want to go to point B, and we are so passionate to go there, so we don't understand that after point B, we inevitably will need to come back to point C, which will be further back, That's what we do. Don't be in a rush, just keep patient, but just see the final goal and go there gradually, step by step. Don't be too overexcited. Don't say, it's good to be patriot, but it's better to be a wise patriot.
Hi, my name is Olena, and I'm from Polovka. First of all, I live in New Haven, and I teach foreign policy at University of New Haven. First of all, thank you so much for being here. Thank you for coming.
You contacted me to you got in touch with me to meet. But sorry for we didn't have that.
Yeah, the reason why I came here is because I contacted you. No. Thank you so much. I just can't even say enough about the energy and the enthusiasm that you bring and the way you mobilize and inspire people. And I did go to the Columbia talk, and I'll tell you, my Facebook never exploded as much as it did. After Columbia talk, the energy that you bring is amazing. Whether you sing or dance or talk or drink coffee, whatever you do.
I'm not gonna dance here. It's Catholic University. So we can dance at Berkeley, California.
You know, he's the kind of person who doesn't shy away from challenge. And that kind of my question was about actually two questions. One is about what you just said, with your competition, right? So, you strike me as the kind of person who doesn't shy away from competition, who welcomes competition, who welcomes challenge. And last time you said that you're surrounded by the smartest people in the world right now, as part of the World Fellows program, and being at Yale and New Haven. And it makes you excited, you're excited about it, you want to learn more, so you welcome competition. And I watched your Brussels concert, and it was amazing how you handpicked different musicians who perhaps are better than you in some ways. And
absolutely.
That's exactly why you bring them to the team. You could have just sang with Akian Nansen, but you wanted to do something different, and you picked people who were, you knew, who could possibly put you in a position where you would look less talented or less experienced. And I really admire your ability to pick a team and not be afraid of competition. Now, my experience with Ukraine, especially with leadership, is that sometimes the problem is not that we have a lack of talented people, is that they don't get hired necessarily, they're not always welcome because they create competition. So how do we change that culture of fear of competition? And you served in Duma, not in Duma, I'm sorry.
Who knows?
in the Ukrainian parliament.
Irada, thank you. I'm from Gorlovka, but true patriot, I promise. Test me later.
They still don't have Duma there.
Freudal slip. Who would have thought? Why did you leave, and did you feel as though people perceived you as too competitive and too powerful to mobilize youth around you?
So, thank you very much. Sorry for probably looking, seeming not attentive, but what was the first question? Is it two questions? And
one question was, how do we eliminate that fear of competition? And my second question was, thank you, was mobilizing youth. What you do so well, and I've seen a lot of people come to the United States, politicians, parliament members, and what I see in you is that ability to mobilize. Would you encourage your partners in crime, your other artists like yourself? I know Ruslana does some of social activism, but would you encourage other musicians to do similar things that you do, to utilize their power to mobilize young people the way you do, and not just care about, you know, pop music and business?
I'll try for the second question. Do I see myself as somebody who is gonna persuade other colleagues to do something only by my own example and only by my own life? I think my life is my example. I can't enforce them. I don't believe that. I don't believe that you can inspire somebody by the other way than just inspire somebody. And if you want to impose your ideas or will, or you want to let them do something obligatory or compulsory, or just put them in a frame so that they feel ashamed, or we feel obliged to do something under circumstances, I don't believe it works. I just don't believe it. It probably will work once or twice. So people you mentioned, and other people, they certainly do a lot of things, and I'm very grateful to everybody, my colleagues, people from arts, people from science, from civil society, from scientists, writers, everybody who, not being today in the offices, political offices, do something, some modest, sometimes not modest, but big things for their own country. I'm one of this team. I feel as one of these people, I will be ready to be, a part of that civil society, which is now being brewed, I don't know, either by God or by other circumstances, but it's being brewed by somebody, something. So, I don't think I have a role to come to everybody and say, do. Actually, I do it now. It's soft power. What you ask, it's a little bit like hard power. Why don't you guys do what I do? It's a sort of moralization and a sort of clashes or contradicts where the principle don't judge and you won't be judged. So I'm doing what I'm doing. I'm never trying to judge or to blame somebody else. The first question is very interesting, and you talk, why do we still have these leaders, they don't accept anybody else? Partly this is because we all come from paternalistic society. You can call it Eastern society, you can call it Soviet society, you can call it whatever, but the truth is that in that society, the competition is not being welcomed as a fact. So when you're in a school, the teacher for you is somebody between the god and a king. And your teacher in America is like your mate, your buddy, who is probably a little bit more experienced or older, so probably, not every time, but probably he knows better. But it doesn't mean that he always knows better,
So your main primarial task is to change, to challenge him and to question him every day. This is a different approach. That's why I want our guys to come here. This is the main thing. Not, I don't think that Columbia or Yale know better how to write formulas than Lviv or Kyiv or Kharkiv University. No. What I know, that at least the idea, the teacher and the educational process is being, like, you know, provided, the people are provided with here, is more suitable for bringing this new kind of leadership. It's just better. It's more practical. It's more consistent. It's something that works better. This is it. Why don't we have that? Partly I explained it. So we need these new people. Secondly, it's also because, who knows, probably we're still either here or here. If these guys are too good for us, so we'll gonna follow them up soon. If we change like this. If these guys are too bad for us, we gotta understand very quickly and we'll change them, believe me. This is my answer.
Thank you.
So 1, 2, and 3, I see 3 hands like that.
Okay, so I'm...
We're not in a hurry, just...
I'm from Ukrainian. I'm studying here, writing my PhD in educational psychology. So I do understand that education is the key, and I totally agree with that. But going back to that, and you were in between saying that you don't know if we're still in first position or the second position. So do you believe that our current leaders in Ukraine deserve our trust, or should we actually control them and pay attention to what they're doing, and they don't deserve our trust as much at all at this point in our history? And do you know, probably because we are learning everything from the news, and you most likely, hopefully, know more about the actual...
Not last from us.
Okay, not in the last half a year or so, but... hopefully more than we do. Do you know leaders that deserve our trust, and would you like to promote them in the soft way? Not pushing, but actually promoting people who we should trust and who we should look up to and help.
Thank you.
You don't want any hypocritical
first.
That's an interesting question too.
First of all, if you ask me, who should you trust? It's already a wrong approach. So you don't ask me, you just know who you want to trust and who you don't. So it's your responsibility. It's not my responsibility to tell you, it's your responsibility to know. You take your responsibility, who do you think are good leaders for your country? And all other 45 million of people in Ukraine take their own responsibility for that. Because the thing is now, we are still thinking that Slava, or Peter, or Paul, or John, or Jacob, or I can name all 12 disciples. Some of them will come and tell you the truth of their commandments. There's no, we need to create these commandments for Ukraine by ourselves. I mean, all of us, not only me, not only you, but both me and you, you know, understand? So my answer to your question, are our leaders, common leaders, and current leaders, do they deserve our trust? I can say only my answer, my personal answer. And my personal answer is probably you will find it sneaky, but it's true. Some of them do, some of them not. Those of them who do, sometimes not. It's very, it's very changeable. And By having said that, I don't mean that everything is either bad or other good. I mean that some things today are being done where we couldn't even imagine they could have been done like two, three years ago. And it's great. Some of things that are being done, from my point of view, are immature, premature, not wise, and probably are wrong things to do. Some of the things that should be done are not being done. So it's like, it's very, I'm not a big supporter of any revolutions in the world. I do think that gradual, evolutional steps are better. The problem is that sometimes we come from point A to point B. You don't need only to gradually move, but sometimes you need to create something extraordinary. I only hope and pray that these extraordinary moments in life, if you pray, will be as few as possible. I don't believe that we can avoid that. That is impossible. We already had a couple of them. I don't know how many still we need to have. It always reminds me a history of French Revolution. When French Revolution in 1789 occurred, people were in the world, especially like progressive, enlightened society, was so excited and encouraged by these events. So they were thinking of the French Revolution as at the beginning of the new world. And it actually took France literally 100 years and two more revolutions after that, 100 years, finally to come to the point where, like, to build their society. They were dreaming from the beginning. At least, I mean, certainly not 100%, but at least for something closer. You remember the first Jacobin times and like the times afterward of restoration and Napoleon, and once again, the royals came once again, a new revolution, and once again, a revival of the royalty, and then finally war with Germany, and many things in 1870, finally, all the last revolution they did, like, you know, or like they became what they are. Once again, I hope that we don't need to have 100 years, but I just want to remind you that many countries went through that. England had even more. They started their changing their society in 1215 with Magna Carta, and they ended up probably in 1700 when William the Orange came from Holland and knew United Kingdom, which we know now, emerged. So it took like 500 years. Like, it took Americans at least 75 years before finally they understood that these two parts of the country live with different rules, and they need to, like, you know, to come to an equilibrium. And equilibrium they found only through a horrible civil war where they lost almost 1 million people. You never know how things happen, but one thing you need to have. You need to have leaders which are ready to sacrifice themselves with strong stamina, and a civil society ready to learn and to get educated and to get enlightened. If you don't have both, you won't have this point when you start doing better. I still think we have a chance. I don't think that our chance is 100%, but you know, I believe it's 100%. I don't think, but I believe. Actually, I think that belief is some fundamental thing we have in life. Actually, you guys who are from this university are being taught every day that belief or faith is something that a man needs. So,
so-called question about the access to foreign education. Some of the notice of elites have access to foreign education for years. So what would be the difference when they're coming back, they're occupying positions thanks to the connections that they have. So what would this salmon of students, exchange students, let's say, from Ukraine, what would be the way for them to make a difference and how to occupy that position? And another thing is, even they get a position, let's say, in finance or in politics, how would they be able to survive with low pay? If they're young, right? So this salary is not enough to provide for themselves, for the family, even work. So what will inspire them to make a change in the country? And how can they do that? How they fight the corruption?
If you have, thank you for the question. If you have a current creek, small river, it's called creek, right? You have a creek, and it comes to a dam, small dam. It stops there for a moment. See? And nobody, because it's called a turbulent current, nobody can come, can evaluate, solve the equation. Where will be the next route of this creek? So, but you know for sure that somehow the water will find its path. Not this way, but that way, not that way. So this is my answer. I don't know how these people will succeed. I just know that a big number of people with this approach will definitely succeed. I'll tell you one story from political science, or probably from economics. If somebody of you guys know the history of Chile, the country Chile, and you know that there was a country very rich on both sides of copper, and that was the only export item they had in their life. So they see, actually they depended only on that. And they lived more or less, I wouldn't say good or bad, but I'd say by Latin American means they live, like standards, they live not very bad. But they were so impressed by socialism, so when at the end they came, they just sort of screwed their economy. You know the things there, I see that you know. So then the guy, infamous or notorious, General Pinochet came. I won't judge and won't say anything about what he did in his politics, because many things that he did were terrible, and we know that. And the lives of people, for me, I think it's a sacred thing. And you know, you never kill people, even for better like ideas. But I don't want to judge or talk about that. There was a famous. Case. Somehow Americans, I don't know, you know better probably, especially Americans, they were backing this new Pinochet approach, so they were like sort of aligning with them and trying to help them or to use them, I don't know. So they imposed the idea that Pinochet should bring these educated guys from the U.S. They were called Chicago Boys. They were called Chicago. Probably they were from Chicago mostly.
University of Chicago.
From the University of Chicago.
Right.
So they came, and after a short analysis, they told Michelle, "You know, we have a state export of copper. We have, and it's, you know, very much regulated. Actually, it's 100% regulated and only dependent on state and on government will. What we need to do is to deregulate it at all and to export everything else. Rely on everything we have." Pinochet reasonably asked them a question. "But what will we export? We don't have it. What is the thing? What is the issue? What are the things
Chile is going to export. And the guy, I don't remember his name, he said, you know, I don't know what are we going to export. But I for sure we know that we will find something. Because he believed in the approach, in the market economy. And that is my idea. You ask me a concrete question, I don't know. You're completely right that nowadays we have problems. But I know that we'll have 10,000 people, young, in their 20s or 30s people, who are educated, who are committed, who are angry in a good way, who want to change their country. They come back and they smash all these old people, old approach, all bad things that we have, and they won't ask what to do. They will come and do the things, you know? That's what I believe. And your second question was about what?
Well, they are coming. They are coming.
Yeah,
once again,
suddenly you see that these low wages is an obstacle. But look at what is happening in many places now in Kiev as well, and many others. So there are people who are willing to try. And the more people will try, are willing to try, the bigger chances are. Secondly, if the level of wage for you isn't the same, is a reason of the same magnitude as the desire to change a country, then probably you're not the right person for that. All Christ's disciples were ready to suffer a lot in order to do something. We can't change the country with approach, I'll wait if they give me $5,000 a box. It doesn't work. And I believe the more people, and people are people, I mean, everybody, I always say we all are weak as human beings. So it's not bad that somebody wants good salary and somebody thinks that's a good reason not to come back because he has not a good salary. It's good, it's normal. The thing is, we don't need normal people. We need different people. And if we have 5,000 normal people, I believe that 100 to 200 from them will be just be sex drawers. It's always like that.
There was a question there, I believe.
My name is Larissa. I'm originally from Iran, from Kiev, now I'm living here in New York. The project I'm working right now is I'm trying to revive the Ukrainian Academy of Art and Sciences. Why? It was created in the 50s by people who came from Ukraine and through Europe, and they were well educated, they wanted to do something for Ukraine. They tried to create a little Ukraine in the United States, in New York. Now, those people, mostly 70, 80, 90 years old, most of them died. So I'm trying to involve more younger people in those organizations. My question is, how do you see diaspora and people who establish their life here can help Ukraine and can help your project? Because what you were saying, let's bring young people here, mm-hmm. they will get mm-hmm. their education and they will go mm-hmm. back to Ukraine or bring American to Ukraine and mm-hmm. just those change. What do you see people who live here, Ukrainian people who live here can do?
First of all, thank you for this question. First of all, we all can do together many things. And I think from both sides, if we have efforts from both sides, it's better than we have efforts from only each of the sides, which are not connected with each other. So we can and need to work jointly. Already people and organizations whom I met, I still, please allow me not to name all of them because we are just in the process of just, you know, creating some ideas. So I met like for three months, many interesting people who proposed their help and some of them and me, we together try to find the best way to push this idea and to make it move forward. When I think in the nearest future, I don't know, give us a couple of months, probably a month or two or three, I don't know. I don't want to be in a rush, actually. I don't want to, like, you know, be lazy, but I don't want to be in a rush. Let us come up with this idea, this basic idea, what we want to do, concrete steps, and what is the plan, and how is it going to be implemented, and then probably many of you guys can join that. The more of us will be there, the better the result will be. And regarding diaspora, I fully respect and feel admire, and I'm fully grateful for all efforts Ukrainian diaspora has been doing for all these years, not only the last 50 years or 60, but starting from 1880s when they started come here, all of them, especially in these central Canadian places, where we have, you know, nowadays we have descendants of these, you know, first immigrants who still speak Ukrainian 100 years after, and new generations and people who came as political refugees after World War II, everybody, all of them, and the people who came right, like, in the next 30 years. So all of them, little by little, do something. So I say thanks to all of them. The only little issue that I'm concerned with is sometimes it feels like these people, many of these people, I won't say all, they still see Ukraine in a framework of the typical turn of the 20th century approach of a nation state the idea of which was first created by in the 19th century thinkers and movements in order to break the empires, and it was movement all over Europe, and it was in Ukraine, and it was in Czech Republic, in Poland, it was in even Jewish people who didn't have their country at the time, they were looking at all these, you know, things, Zionist movements and that whole thing, that all was created in the 19th century, and that basic approach was that if we have some place where we have some people who have the same culture, speak the same language, and share the same habits, they do have right to create their own country, a so-called self-determination point. In 1920s, most of these empires broke, and most of these countries gained their own independence and started their own countries. Ukraine wasn't that lucky because of different reasons. I don't want to talk about that now, although somebody asked a question, but I don't want to talk about that much. So we were not lucky that much. But the problem is that the end of the 20s and the beginning of the 21st century, we already became independent and we started to think of our country. Many still think of a new state nation, Ukrainian nation state, in this framework or approach of the beginning of the 20th century, which is, from my point of view, not the proper one today. So we need to stop thinking of our country as a country which has common habits or culture or past. We don't have that anymore. I mean, we have that, but it was something in the past. We need to build a country. And that country is just a territory with these people who share their future and want to share common values. This is what we need to talk about today. And sometimes I feel, thank you, sometimes I feel that people who left Ukraine many, many years ago are still not very happy with that. I know that is a controversial thing for many what I say, but I want us to build a country, a real state nation. America was built by many nationalities, by many people coming from all over the world who shared common values. Ukraine has a chance to build a country of different people with different past, from different cultural approaches, from different, you know, many things, but still living together and sharing common values and having common future. That's what we need to build. And I want all of us to see this as a main idea of building Ukraine. I will tell you even more, like, I will be even more daring. I don't believe that the other approach today is possible. I don't believe that without that approach, Ukraine is gonna survive. Not anybody there, it's okay. Because there was some other people, but they're not raising their hands.
Okay, my name is Lubar. I'm originally from Ivano from Kyiv, that's my nature, Carpathian. Based on all the story which you tell us, leadership, civil side, the riots, and this place, I have a very simple question. How you see in the future in Ukraine, and what kind of wish you have for the new generation? And how you see that new people or young people, which is helping get good education, good prosperity in the future. How you have some maybe the best wishes for this young people? Can you comment on that?
May you specify your question a little bit? So what do
you
mean?
How you can see from this moment, for example, right now, so hard situation in Ukraine, and How you can see that 10 years, for example,
1,000 years.
Maybe you can, you have some wish, or you can some, you have some unique wishes for that people who can grow up in Ukraine and move to Ukraine from Ukraine to the United States and to get better education, better opportunity in life. Do you have some wish for that people?
My wish is very simple. To hold on, to stay strong, to not to give up, both mentally and literally. Spiritually, I do believe, I really do believe that these people, not only these those who come to America or to other countries to get educated themselves, but generally these new people, these new kind of people, self-responsible, ready to risk, ready to fight, ready to sacrifice, ready to commit themselves, and also knowing how to do that. These will be this new kind of leaders and the kind of people who change the country. One more thing, actually two more observations that I want to share with you is, we're talking about Ukraine here a lot. We must remember that today we live in a different world, which is so much, I would say interchangeable, so much. Thomas Friedman from Washington Post says that he wrote the book, The World is Flat. So we're living in a flat world where it's not enough to be a part of your country anymore. You need to be both a man of your country and a man of the world. And 100 years ago, it still worked. Although even 100 years ago, countries like United Kingdom or America, these big internationally important nations, they already had different approach. But nowadays, it's not only desirable, it's like just impossible to think different. So what we need is also to broaden up our horizons. We need to stop thinking with the framework of our border, national border. We need to think of all processes that are going on in the world. You ask me about 10, 15, 20 years, people can't predict what is going to be in the world in 20 years, because the world is being changed so quickly. It's changing so quickly. And what we need to do, we need to run fast. Because if we run slow, we'll be behind. And as you understand, now with the problem of sustainability in the world, everybody want to be in the world, want to be as prosperous as Switzerland, Norway, or America. Everybody. But you know, to be as prosperous as Switzerland or America, you need to consume and to use as much as America. And if the world is going to use as much or consume as much as America, it's not going to survive. I mean, we can't do that. It's just not enough room, energy, and capacities in the world to maintain the growth for all over the world. That means that somebody will be left behind. I don't want Ukraine to be left behind. Okay, so we have, we need to stop at 3:30, right?
Yes.
So it's like 3:20, so we have very short. Somebody else has some questions, 1, 2, and 3. Okay, 3 questions. One from that side, somebody. Okay. 1, 2, 3. It was first. No. Okay. What is it for you? It's a problem to survive.
We don't know how much you know as the United States law. I don't necessarily know. Well, they have two very different, they both do two very different things. I don't necessarily
how it looks. Okay, so what's different?
Well, you're looking at Western Europe and the United States for sending and they have, like I said, they have two very different examples in terms of government and in terms of lifestyle and culture, and what you're looking to bring to Ukraine in terms of that.
I still don't get what you mean.
Right.
You're saying, okay, you always say what I say,
sorry.
What you do.
Okay. Well, for instance, I think that taking standpoints in globalism, and like you just answered the last question, would be a good move. It's something that a lot of different parts of Europe still haven't had access to, as well as many other countries in the world haven't had the ability to reach out yet on the scale that the United States and a lot of Western Europe has. But is that all we're looking at? Like the ability to access the world and be a part of the whole world.
You say that you disagree with this Western approach. You have some different ones, so that's why I say.
I think, for instance, I'd like to remember, like, I think we have a long way to go as a country in terms of.
Sorry, a little bit lower.
Sorry, in terms of, like, the United States, I've lived here my whole life,
yeah.
And I think that we have a lot to do in terms of social issues. So I think that we need to be enlightened in that aspect.
Absolutely right. But what is wrong in Western values?
Oh, no, I'm not saying there's anything wrong. I'm just asking what you're looking to take from it.
Okay, now I see the question.
Sorry.
Finally. Okay, that's a good question. I don't think that to live the world, the life of Americans or some countries in Europe, because they're different, live as a panacea for Ukraine. We certainly need to have our own approach. And certainly we will have, because every country in the world is unique and was built under different conditions and different circumstances, and certainly We don't have even two unique states. And some states are even being changed. States are always like, you don't have permanent states. Like the idea of a state is only like 400 years old. I mean, before that we had completely different maps. So you're right. So in the case of like, you don't need to focus and to hate somebody. And we don't want, I don't want to hate somebody. When I say about what I like, for example, in Western approach, I formulated it probably very simple. I like the way they teach, they learn young people to question things. For example, you question me. You say that you don't agree. You're probably one of very few people who was there to say that you disagree with me here in this audience. And I just want everybody to have something to disagree with me and to say something different, because then we will have a joint result, which from my point of view is much better than something imposed in a Plato sense for a wise Slava or wise somebody else, to everybody else to be accepted. It's a typical Western approach, and it's jointly. It's the same in the United States or Canada or Australia or the UK or Germany or France, to less extent, Southern Europe, to less extent. But it also has, this approach is working. Once again, it's not 100% at the same level, but even in Confucian societies like Japan or Singapore or Taiwan, it's still working. So Ukraine still lacks of that. If you come to Ukraine, you'll understand what I'm talking about. And it's not, you know, it's not the way, like, you know, you do coffee. Especially not the way you do. And it was two last questions. There were one. Yeah.
Hello. How are you? My question is a little similar. If in ideal world you became a minister of the Ukrainian educational system, what would you personally change? Maybe you leave something. Mm-hmm. Like I was getting rid of chemistry in 7th grade. What would you do? What do you like in a Western vocation? What you dislike? What you like about?
I already told you, and I'll say once again, okay, there are two things we need to change. And both of these two things are not like specific things like subjects, as a approach, a framework. So the first thing, we need to diminish a line or a gap between teacher and pupil. Because I think in today's world, if earlier teacher was necessary to give you an information, because he was a source of information and you were not. So in order to get information, you were to listen to him, because he was your Google or Wikipedia. And nowadays, you don't need that from teachers. I mean, you have everything in Google or Wikipedia, you just don't need that. So what do you need? Teacher needs to find a way to extract from you what is your best. And it's the second approach. I mean, the second thing we need to change. So part of the gap, or the diminishing of the gap, we also need to change what we give to our children. We should stop giving them just an information. Because today, information worth nothing. It's free of charge, it's cheap, it's everywhere. You just go and grab it. I mean, it's much cheaper than coffee Starbucks. Go and grab it, it's free of charge. Go and it's there. Well, probably suddenly you need to learn how to read, to be but literacy it's not an issue, especially when we talk about Ukraine. We are one of the most literate countries in the world. So we already on the point we can have our information we want to have. And I don't think that it's the worst thing that the child, especially somebody in his adolescent years, is going to have a freedom of choice what information to choose. Sometimes it's the bad information, so you need a sort of, you know, to pilot them, but only to pilot, not in impose things. But the second most important change we need to do is not to give an information. We need to, teacher need to have an ability to get a talent, to extract a talent from the child, just to what well, before the children or before pupils, by the time they finish their high school, they need to know what is their strongest and what is that their signature dish, you know? So everybody in the class should know that I'm good at that. I'm a dancer. I'm a very plastic. I'm good like in sciences. I can do math. I can learn by heart many poems. I can draw. I can do this. I can do that. And then by the time you're like 17, 18, 16, you know what you're gonna do next, and you will be the pilot of your life after that. So the pilot, which was your teacher, so it's like the teacher should be an instructor in your play, sitting next to you. You are both having a wheel. How we call it in the play? It's not a wheel, but anyway, like this, joystick or whatever. I don't know.
Tiller.
So you both have tiller, but before you, when you're young, you know, experienced, this is only in the will of your instructor. But then, little by little, you both start ruling things. By the time you get older, he says, okay, stop by here, I'm coming, I'm like young. You drop me off, not suddenly in the air, just, you know, and then it's your own pilot, your own plane, your life, your pilot, go ahead. So that's what he or she needs to do with you. And both of these things are not implemented in Ukraine. How to do it practically? Frankly speaking, I still don't know. But frankly speaking, I didn't think of that because I can't think of all the things simultaneously. So I'm not running for the office of the Ministry of Education so far, and probably I won't ever, because my job is to give, to raise questions and probably to inspire people, I think. But I think there are many people who are much better executives than I am, so let them do the job. And the last question. Yeah? Sorry.
I represent the non-Ukrainians. My name is Vera, and I also actually want to thank Olena for organizing this. I grew up in St. Petersburg. I read most of my adult life here in the States. You mentioned the importance of attracting foreign professionals, but as a foreign professional who has no connection to Ukraine or the Ukrainian community, I would personally not know where to turn to offer my help. I know plenty of resources where I can offer money, financial resources, but not a single resource where I can offer money, professional experience. Mm-hmm. So have you thought up, or will you think of creating a single resource where
absolutely
foreign professionals can turn as individuals to offer?
Thank you very much. That's a very good question for the last question. If to talk about that fundamentally, that's the job of the government. But we are not, not losing our perspective or losing our focus on these things. So we will not only think of bringing students from Ukraine to America, or some students or volunteers from America to Ukraine. Actually, the second is very important as well. That's what, for example, Georgians did with English language. They brought a lot of, Georgia's not very big, but they got a lot of volunteer American students who were willing to go there and just to teach Georgian children English. And it was a great thing to do, because if you are 18, 20, you're still beginning your life, you don't ask for $5,000 in a month like a salary, you just do a fund. And it's come to go to different country and also to do some good job, do good things, because children here are being taught that to do charity is good. It's a very typical Protestant, you know, approach to life. You just need to do something. And they are willing to help. But the hardest thing is to attract really like professionals who can do something. There are some ambassadors of Ukraine here in the States, I know, who has nothing to do with Ukraine. Some of these people are very helpful and are very committed in things to help Ukraine. You need to find them, to dig a little bit, and you see how many of them. For example, one of the professors in my class on the decision making was a Nobel Prize winner of economics, a professor of Chicago University, Roger Meyerson, who has no links to Ukraine, He has a lot of things to do with Ukraine. He has links with many Ukrainian new people who try to start, who like, you know, want to rebuild the country. He participates in building this concept of decentralization, which is very vital for Ukraine now, in some economic things, and even we were like, I see how committed and how, you know, he thinks it's important for him. So people like him, so probably you won't find thousands of like people, but at least you can find tens and probably hundreds of these people. You just need to find. Somebody needs to be responsible for that. So I think we're gonna find this way, our way to find these people and to, as you say, to create a platform or, I don't know, call it application, to let this happen. And it's very important. Guys, thank you everybody for coming here. Time. Hope we next time see you. I think Ukraine was here in the concert.